بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. هو الذي بعث في الأميين رسولا منهم يتلو عليهم آياته ويزكيهم ويعلمهم الكتاب والحكمة وإن كانوا من قبل لفي ضلال مبين.
QSEP.com, your step-by-step guide to learning Islam online. Tawheed Explained from the book Aqidatu Tawheed by Sheikh Saleh bin Fawzan Al-Fawzan. Presentation and explanation by Dr. Abdullah Al-Farisi.
الحمد لله وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن نبينا محمدا عبده ورسوله. This is a continuation from كتاب التوحيد by His Honor the Great Sheikh صالح الفوزان. And today, inshallah, the topic will be regarding the claiming of the knowledge of the unseen and the innovations and shirk attached to this, including what is called today astrology and fortune telling and magic and things of that nature. First of all, what is meant by ghaib, or the knowledge of the unseen, or the knowledge of the hidden? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Quran, قُلْ لَا يَعْلَمُ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ الْغَيْبَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. This is verse 65 of Surah An-Naml. So the knowledge of the unseen is not known except by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, most glorious. And if he wishes, he might inform some of his messengers partial knowledge of the unseen, as it is according to his wisdom, glory be to him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, عالم الغيب فلا يظهر على غيبه أحدا إلا من ارتضى من رسول. Verses 26-27 from Surah Al-Jin. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not show the knowledge of the unseen except for those whom he has chosen amongst his messengers. He might tell them partial knowledge, some knowledge of the unseen. And this is for great wisdoms, such as to strengthen the faith of the followers of the Prophet. Because if he tells of some of the futuristic, for example, matters, and they show to be true, then the people's faith will strengthen. And this is needed for the followers of the prophets, especially the companions of the prophets, because they are the foundation of their nation. And therefore, for their faith to be very strong, it is very important. And this includes both messengers, the messengers amongst the humans and the messengers amongst the angels. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala do not inform others or other than the messengers. So anyone who claims the knowledge of the unseen by any means, then he is a liar and he is a kafir, because he is directly opposing the verses in Quran regarding the knowledge of unseen to be only by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whether the person who claims this claims it by reading the palm or reading in a small pot, which usually is used for tea or coffee or whatever, or by fortune telling or by magic or by astrology or any other way. Now, regarding astrology, any part of astrology which is based on scientific calculations is excluded from what we are speaking about today, which is the knowledge of the unseen. Because when scientific calculations occur, this has nothing to do with claiming the knowledge of the unseen. And this, what we are speaking today, is regarding what happens from some of the ignorance who use magic or use confused knowledge, whatever they call it. They use claims which are based on nonsense and based on speculation. They use claims that they can find what is hidden, wherever it might be hidden, to tell about futuristic things and so on. And they go on claiming that by this they can provide some cures for diseases and so on. They usually use the devils, the shayateen, in their acts. And they try to fool the people and make them think that they are doing it by themselves by using certain means. Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah said that those fortune tellers, each one of them has a shaitan whom he deals with. And this shaitan informs him of some of the unseen and some of the hidden. And of course, the shayateen have a mixture of truth and falsehood in their talk. Until he said, Shaykh al-Islam, amongst those people who are dealing with those shayateen, the shayateen come to them with certain kinds of food, like fruits or sweets or other than that. And some shayateen carry those people who deal with them and fly them to Mecca or to Jerusalem or some other places. Sometimes they base their claims on astrology, and that is to use the different movements of the stars as signs of some incidents which happen on the earth. They claim that they get the knowledge by thoroughly following stars, where they go and which direction they move and so on. And they claim that he who marries, for example, when such star meets such star, then such and such will happen to him. And he who travels, when such star meets with another star, then again such and such happened to him. One who is born from meeting this star with that star will be such and such, and so on. This is mentioned usually in the magazines and newspapers to fool the people, the common people. Some ignorant people and those with weak faith will go to such tyrants or such claimers, and they will ask them about their future life and what's going to happen, about their marriage, etc. Anyone who claims the knowledge of unseen and anyone who believes him in his claim is a mushrik. He is a kafir. He is not a Muslim. Because he who claims the knowledge of the unseen, then he is claiming to be equal to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in something which is special of him only, and that is the knowledge of the unseen. The stars are nothing but creatures which are run by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It has no control of its own. It has no rule by itself. It is not a sign on any misery or otherwise, or life or death of someone. This is all the acts of shayateen. Then the Sheikh speaks about magic and fortune telling. He starts by saying that all these are acts of devil and they are haram, and they contradict the true aqeedah, because no good can occur with involving in matters of shirk. Regarding magic, sihr, it is a word which means what is hidden, something which its cause is hidden or vague or unknown. This is the word sihr. And it is called as such because usually it happens with hidden ways that are not seen by the people who are witnessing it. And it could be in the form of omnits, or in the form of recited words, or in the form of some kind of smokes and some kind of old medicine. And magic has a true effect. No one denies this but an innovator. The group of Mu'tazila denied the truthfulness of sihr. They denied that it actually has effects, true effects, and it actually occurs. They said it is nothing but imagination. All sihr is imagination. This is not true. And some of the sihr affects the hearts and the bodies. The person who is subject to this might get sick and he might die. And some of it causes the split of the man from his wife, or vice versa. And of course, it occurs by the will of Allah. That is the universal will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and not the legalistic will. The legalistic will means that Allah has ordered it. And this is not true. Allah has forbidden it and called it kufr in Quran. So it occurs by the universal will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Anything which occurs, good or bad, sin or obedience, kufr or faith, is by the universal will of Allah, because nothing can occur in the universe forcibly on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So magic is a satanic act, and most of it cannot be achieved except by falling into great shirk or small shirk, and to worship the shayateen. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned it with shirk. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, avoid the seven destroyers amongst sins. They said, what are they? He said, al-ishraku billah was-sihr, to associate partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to make magic, to involve into magic. This hadith narrated by Bukhari and Muslim. And magic falls into shirk from two points. The first is because it involves using the devils and attaching oneself to them and pleasing them with certain actions, which might be great shirk. A devil might ask the person who is dealing with him to sacrifice an animal for him. And this is great shirk, because this is a worship. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَكِنَّ الشَّيَاطِينَ كَفَرُوا يُعَلِّمُونَ النَّاسَ السِّحْرِ. This is verse 102 from Surah Al-Baqarah. The second way, or the second thing that shows that sihr or magic involves shirk or is part of shirk, is that the one who uses magic usually claims the knowledge of the hidden, or the unseen, or the future. So it is also another way of resembling Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because no one knows the hidden and unseen and the futuristic except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is again kufr and clear astray. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَقَدْ عَلِمُوا لَمَنْ اشْتَرَاهُ مَا لَهُ فِي الْآخِرَةِ مِنْ خَلَاقٍ. This is verse 102, Surah Al-Baqarah. The fortune telling and the astrology also involve telling about the future, claiming the knowledge of the future or the hidden, like telling what's going to happen on this earth. They say in such and such year this will happen, and so on. Or to inform about something hidden somewhere. This is all using the devils, the shayateen. And the shayateen can still spy on the first heaven. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, هَلْ أُنَبِّئُكُمْ عَلَى مَنْ تَنَزَّلُ الشَّيَاطِينَ تَنَزَّلُ عَلَى كُلِّ أَفَّاكٍ أَثِيمٍ يُلْقُونَ السَّمْعَ وَأَكْثَرُهُمْ كَاذِبُونَ Verses 221 to 223 from Surah Al-Shu'ara. Shaytan could steal a word by spying on the angels who are in the first heaven. And because he is subject to severe punishment, he goes there spying, but in a very fearful manner. Therefore, he makes sure that he is not punished. So he takes the word quickly and runs away. Now that word could be one word out of a sentence or one word out of two sentences. And therefore, usually he doesn't take the right thing. So he takes this word and he goes and puts it in the ear of the person, the human whom he is dealing with, the astrologist or the fortune teller or the magician. And the person will add a lot of lies to this word to make it look good. And the people will believe him. Because one time out of 100 times, he said something true. So therefore, the people get fooled by him and they believe him. So anyone who claims the knowledge of the unseen, or anyone who believes this person, then he has set a companion with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in something that is special of him, namely the knowledge of the unseen. And fortune telling is not free from shirk, because again the fortune tellers make some kinds of worships to the devils. So it is indeed a way of committing shirk in rububiyyah, in lordship, by claiming the knowledge of the hidden and unseen. And it is also a way of committing shirk in uluhiyyah, worship, by worshipping the devil in order for the devil to help you in whatever knowledge that he claims. Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu narrated about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam saying, he who comes to a fortune teller and believes him in what he says, then he has committed kufr to what has been revealed on Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, narrated by Abu Dawood. And also the magicians, fortune tellers and astrologists play with the people's beliefs because they show themselves as curers of diseases. And they order the sick person, the weak person who is coming to them as a means of savior, they order him to go and slaughter something for other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For example, they tell him go and slaughter a sheep which has the following descriptions. And they say, they tell him whatever color, whatever description they tell him. Or slaughter a chicken which has the description of such and such. This is how they do it. So whatever is slaughtered for other than Allah. And it is slaughtered for the shayateen. They also write for them vague words which contain shirk. And they make them hang such things in their necks or put those things in certain boxes in the home or any other place in the home. And some fortune tellers and astrologists represent themselves as people who know what's lost and things which are hidden and so on. So the ignorant people come and ask him about those lost things. So he would tell them and he would bring those things to them by his devil agents. And some of those fortune tellers show themselves in the form of wali, who can perform acts which are unusual, like, for example, entering the fire without affecting them, or hitting himself with a sharp thing, a sword, whatever, without being hurt. Or he might put himself under the tires, with the wheels of a car or whatever, and not get hurt. Or any other ways of fooling the ignorance. And all those things that they do involves the support of the shayateen, the devils. Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, when he was arguing with some of the magicians which attributed themselves to a Sufi sect called Al-Ahmadiyya Al-Rifa'iyya, he said, this Shaykh of Al-Ahmadiyya Al-Rifa'iyya or Al-Bata'ihiyya, he was shouting at Shaykh al-Islam as if to scare him or something, and he claimed certain unusual things and descriptions, like going into the fire and that nothing will happen to them and that nothing can do this but them, and that therefore they should be submitted to. Shaykh al-Islam told them, I said, with raising my voice also and speaking with anger, I talk to every Ahmadi, meaning those who follow this sect. I talk to every Ahmadi, from the eastern part of the earth to the western part. Whatever they do in the fire, I can do what they do. And he who gets burned, then he is beaten. So Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah challenged them. He knows their trick. He knows they are fooling the people. So he challenged them. And sometimes he would tell them, anyone who is burnt, then he has the curse of Allah. But with one condition. And Shaykh al-Islam says to them that I will do this with one condition, that all of us wash our bodies before throwing into ourselves into the fire. Wash our body with vinegar and hot water. So the people and the leaders, the rulers, asked me, why is that? He said, because they have tricks, they make things which can, by putting them on their body, they can enter hellfire. They make it from the oil of the frogs and the peels of naringe and some kind of rocks and so on. So the people were aware of this, and they became astonished from this. So Shaykh al-Islam said, we do such and such. They said, okay. They said, okay. So the magician pointed his hands as if he wanted to take off his shirt. So I said, no, until you wash yourself, as I said. So the magician acted as if he is not hearing what Shaykh al-Islam said, as they usually do to fool the people. So then I said, anyone who loves the Amir, let him bring wood. So I said, the magician said, he who loves the ruler, let him bring such and such. So I said, Shaykh al-Islam means, he said, no, this is going to take long and is not going to help the purpose. Anything could light a fire. And I and you put our fingers in it after washing it. And he whose finger is burnt, then the curse of Allah be upon him, or he is beaten. So when I said that, and he realized that he has no way but to do what I said, he backed up. The magician didn't even put his finger, let alone his body, because all the way he was fooling those people. And this is just to give an example of how those people perform their acts and fool the people. Then the Sheikh goes to the issue of giving sacrifices, oaths, gifts to the places where some people are buried, and some people who are special, they call them walis or whatever, and they يعني give great respect to their graves. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has closed all means, all ways to shirk, and he has warned from shirk and what leads to shirk very strongly. Amongst those things are the graves where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has set for us the means which will protect us from exaggeration and from falling into shirk. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam warned from making exaggerations in the pious people, because that would lead to worship them. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, be aware of exaggeration, al-ghulu, because what has destroyed those before you was such exaggeration. Narrated by Ahmad, Tirmidhi, and Ibn Majah. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, do not exaggerate in praising me like the Christians have exaggerated in Isa ibn Maryam, Jesus. I am only but a slave. So say the slave of Allah and his messenger. Narrated by Bukhari. The second thing is that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam warned against building on the graves. As narrated Abu al-Hiyaj al-Asadi, he said that Ali ibn Abi Talib radiyallahu anhu said, shouldn't I send you to do something that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has sent me for before? Don't leave any statue except that you deface it or destroy it, and do not leave a high grave where it is risen above the ground except that you make it leveled with the earth. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam forbidden building anything on the graves. Jabir radiyallahu anhu said, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam forbidden us from building on the grave, or to sit on the grave, or to make some kind of a building on it. This is narrated by Muslim. The third thing is that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam warned against praying near the graves. Aisha radiyallahu anha said, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he was very sick at the end, towards the end of his life, he was putting some kind of wet cloth on his face to reduce the effect of the fever. So whenever his breath would get weak, he would take off that piece of cloth from his face, and he would say, the curse of Allah be upon Jews and Christians, for they have taken the graves of their prophets as mosques, places of worship. Aisha says, he was warning against what they have done, otherwise his grave would be shown, but he was afraid that it might be taken as a mosque or a place of worship. This is narrated by Bukhari and Muslim. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, those nations before you were making the graves of their prophets as mosques. So do not take the graves as mosques. I forbid you from that. Narrated by Muslim. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he said, do not make it as mosques, making it mosques means to pray near them, even if you don't build a mosque on it. Any place which is meant for prayer is called a mosque, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, جُعِلَتْ لِيَ الْأَرْضُ مَسْجِدًا وَطَهُورًا. And most of the people who do this nowadays have actually clearly acted against the orders of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They have done what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has strongly warned against, And because of what they have done, they have fallen into great shirk. They built graves and they built places which they call different names. They make special buildings on the grave and they give it names, whatever they call it. And they make them places which they occasionally visit and go around and seek the blessings from and so on. And they perform great forms or many forms of great shirk, like sacrificing animals, like supplication to the engraved, and other acts of great shirk. Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah says, anyone who looks at the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam regarding graves, what he has ordered us regarding them and what he has forbidden us regarding them, and also what the companions of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam were on regarding that, and compares all that to what most of the people do nowadays, he would find one of them is strongly opposing the other, meaning those people are opposing the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and going against the orders of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and falling into what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has forbidden and warned against severely. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, don't pray to the graves, and those people pray there. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, do not take them as mosques, and those people build mosques on them and consider them places of dua and worship and also many other acts of shirk. So, as a matter of fact, some of them consider those places like Mecca, like Kaaba, like Hajj. Actually, they make books and they call those books the manasik of Hajj to the graves. The sets of rules of Hajj to the graves. They even call it Hajj. And we know there is no Hajj but to one place, and that is Kaaba, and not to the grave of someone. And those people take it as a set place to visit in set times, once a year, twice a year, once every month, once every Ramadan, once every Rajab, once every Sha'ban, once whatever. And this falls under the expression or the word Eid. The Prophet ﷺ said, do not take my grave as Eid. Eid is from Aada, Ya'udu, to do it over and over in a set time. This is Eid. And the mushriks used to do this. So, unfortunately, those people have made such graves as Eids. Also, we mentioned the hadith of Ali radiallahu anhu. Another hadith by Thumama ibn Shufay, he said, we were with Fadala ibn Ubaid in the Romans country. One of our friends died, so Fadala said, we should make his grave leveled to the ground. Then he said, I heard the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ordering us to level the graves to the ground. And those people nowadays, they go clearly against those hadiths and orders of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They not only make the graves high above the ground, but they compete in making all kinds of beautified buildings and put all kinds of beautified clothes and things like that. And of course, there are a lot of harms in this and a lot of evils in this, because the next generations or the generations to come will worship such places. Actually, it happened already. The people, ignorant people, are worshiping those places by sacrificing, by supplication, and so on. These are all worships which make them mushriks, kafirs. And Islam, alhamdulillah, did not forbid us from visiting the graves. Visiting the graves is a favorable action which you will be rewarded for, as long as you do it according to the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that is to go near the grave, and because this engraved is someone special to you, you will remember the hereafter and remember that this person was with you, let's say yesterday or whatever, last year or whatever, and then he is now under the ground, no moves, nothing. So you will remember the hereafter, and you will fear death, and you will prepare for the hereafter. This is the purpose of visiting the graves. And when you come near that grave, you will also do a favor to the engraved by asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be merciful for him and so on. But those ignorant people, they go to the grave for the purpose of making the engraved as means between them and Allah. And this is great shirk, like the shirk of Abu Jahl and Abu Lahab. And they go to the grave so that they seek the blessings. And there is no blessings as such except from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this kind of seeking blessing is great shirk. And alhamdulillah, when the Prophet ﷺ made the dua saying, Allahumma la taj'al qabri wathanan yu'bad. Oh Allah, do not make from my grave as an idol to be worshipped. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has answered his call. The grave of the Prophet ﷺ cannot be reached from anywhere because it's within three walls, and all those walls are inclined. They are purposely built inclined so that no one can see the grave and turn himself to the grave for worship. Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah mentioned in his poetry Nuniyya, فَاسْتَجَابَ رَبُّ الْعَالَمِينَ دُعَاءَهُ وَأَحَاطَهُ بِثَلَاثَةِ الْجُدْرَانِ. This is what we meant, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answered his call and his grave was built in a way such that no one can turn to it. Then the Shaykh goes on to the rulings regarding the statues. And of course, the statue is the picture, the full picture of a human or whatever, which has a head and face. This is called timthal or statue. And the mushriks used to put those statues and make all kinds of shirk near them. They used to call them nusub. And now they call them nusub tidhkariya, memorial nusub, memorial statues. And this is haram because this is a way of worshipping those statues someday. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has warned against taking or making pictures of anything which has a soul, especially those people who have special positions amongst the people, like scholars, kings, worshippers, and so on. These kind of pictures are haram, whether they are statues or they are drawings on papers or any form of pictures like the ones taken by cameras, whatever. These are all called pictures. And those things are means to great shirk. The first shirk which occurred on earth was because of making pictures, as Allah mentioned in Quran. Those people which were considered to be pious, Wad, wa Yaghuth, wa Ya'uq, wa Nasr. These names are mentioned in Quran, verse 23, Surat Nuh. And the result of making such pictures led to worshipping them besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this was the first great shirk which Prophet Nuh alayhi salam was sent to warn against. After that, the Shaykh goes into another chapter, and that is to mock the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or to mock what he has made haram, his rulings. Now, maybe the Shaykh has started with fortune-telling and the knowledge of the unseen and the magic and things like that because it is most popular, unfortunately. And then comes the issues of mocking the religion or anything from the religion. And this is great kufr. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in Quran saying, قُلْ أَبِ اللَّهِ وَآيَاتِهِ وَرَسُولِهِ كُنْتُمْ تَسْتَهْزِئُونَ لَا تَعْتَذِرُوا قَدْ كَفَرْتُمْ بَعْدَ إِيمَانِكُمْ. This is verses 65-66 from Surah At-Tawbah. The story behind this verse was that some Muslims, not kafirs, not hypocrites, some Muslims, maybe new Muslims at that time or weak Muslims, but anyway, some Muslims were on the way to a certain battle. And on their way, they were joking. They were joking, making jokes. And amongst their jokes were some words about those companions who were very serious in memorizing Quran and reciting Quran. Qurra, they are called Qurra from reciting Quran. So those jokers, they started to make fun of those Qurra, special kinds of companions of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And they were saying that those Qurra have nothing but eating and this and that. They were lying and making jokes to just to laugh, just for the sake of laughing. Of course, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uncovered their situation to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and revealed the verses that they have no excuse to do that, and they have become kafirs after they were Muslims. قَدْ كَفَرْتُمْ بَعْدَ إِيمَانِكُمْ. You have become kafirs after you were Muslims. And you notice in this verse, Allah did not excuse them with their ignorance, because such ignorance is not accepted, because they had the great scholar, the Prophet ﷺ, and the other companions who were scholars also. They could ask. They don't have the right to do something like this for the sake of jokes without knowing that this is kufr. They had no right to do so. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not excuse them. And therefore, anyone who mocks Allah or Quran or clear sunnah or even the scholars of sunnah, he is a kafir. He is not a Muslim. Because the scholars of the sunnah represent the sunnah. The scholars of the Sharia represent the Sharia. They represent Quran. They represent the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And to mock them for the religion that they are following is mocking the religion itself. To mock them for the Sharia which they are following is mocking the Sharia. And to mock the Sharia is great kufr. Of course, when you mock someone who is doing something wrong, because of that wrong thing, you mock that wrong thing in him and you make fun of that wrong thing, this is not kufr. But when you laugh at the scholars, make joke about the scholars because of what they are carrying of the Sharia, then you are kafir indeed. Unfortunately, we have some ignorance nowadays who claim that those who mock the religion cannot be called kafirs until the proof is established against them, and until we know what's in their heart, and all this kind of garbage and ignorance which they call knowledge. This is not knowledge, this is garbage. And this is something which has no basis in the Quran and Sunnah. Establishing of the truth against someone is not for those clear matters which everyone is supposed to know. They are called in Arabic, al-ma'lumu min ad-dini bid-darura. Something which should be known by every Muslim necessarily. Like knowing that the obligatory prayers are five. If you are living amongst Muslims and say that I don't have to pray five times, I have to pray four times only, or six times, or seven times, you are a kafir. You are not a Muslim. And you are not excused, because you are living amongst Muslims and you are saying something which is against what all the Muslims know. So you cannot be excused. How could you be excused? So in this case, we don't say that this person should not be called a kafir until the proof is established against him. What proof? The proof is the Quran. He is reading the Quran and he is seeing the Muslims going to five prayers, and he knows this is something that everyone should know. The one who is excused for this example is a person, for example, who lives in a country of kufr, a place of kufr, which is far away from Muslim places and no information about Islam at all reaches, which is hypothetical nowadays, yani hypothetical, huh? Which is, even in non-Islamic countries, this is hypothetical, huh? I think every place in America, every city, every school, I've seen their history books, they have something about Islam in them, that Muslims are such and such, they pray five times a day, they don't eat pigs. They have this in their history books, even in America, in kafir countries, in every school. They have this. So for someone to come in Saudi Arabia, for example, and claim that we only have to pray five times, then we have some ignorance nowadays who claim that, well, this person, we better not call him a kafir because this is very dangerous to call someone a kafir. Yeah, it is dangerous, but it's not like this. When someone is committing clear kufr, then if you doubt his kufr, you are like him. If you doubt that Christians are kafirs, then you are like them. If you doubt that Jews are kafirs, then you are like them. If you doubt that grave worshippers are kafirs, then you are more worthy to be like them. Because saint worshippers, whether they call themselves Muslims or whatever, they are into kufr more than Jews and Christians. I mean, those Jews and Christians who are not worshipping the graves. Of course, there are also Jews and Christians who worship the graves. But you have some Jews and Christians who consider it ignorance and kufr to worship the graves. Because they worship Isa, Jesus, and they worship his mother maybe. But they don't worship the graves. But those people worship the graves when they are in Muslim countries. And then there comes a fool and says, you cannot declare them kafirs. Why? Because he says, Allah will not punish people except by sending a prophet to them, and we have to establish the prophet, things like that. This is not true. We can abstain from calling people who worship the saints kafirs when they live in a country where this kind of knowledge is hidden from everyone, absent. No one whatsoever in this country knows the ruling of supplication to the dead and to the saints. No one knows it. Everyone thinks that it is halal and it's good because of their ignorance, which is hypothetical now. As Sheikh Ibn Baz, rahimahullah, says, like in the vast caves of Africa, Sheikh Ibn Baz says, like in the vast caves of Africa, Majahil Afriqia. Majahil. Majahil means a place which is hidden from people. Okay? And like Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah says, in a vast desert, very far from Muslim countries, okay, where no knowledge whatsoever, things like this might occur. And then we should not call them kafirs until they are taught. This is the example that Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah has given, and Shaykh Ibn Baz, rahimahullah, and all Mashayikh of Ahl-Sunnah. Other than this, there is no excuse, as those people claim. So those people, by saying about the companions those words, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described them as kafirs, and he did not excuse them. And he ordered the Prophet ﷺ not to excuse them until they repent from this. And they sent some person to represent them and seek forgiveness and excuse from the Prophet ﷺ, and the Prophet ﷺ did not say more than what the verse said. He was repeating the verse, saying to them, do not apologize. You have committed kufr after you were Muslims. That's all. Even though they sent someone saying, we are sorry, we were only joking, that means they did not know what they were doing is kufr. They did not know this. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not excuse. At least they knew they are doing something wrong. Then the Sheikh has shown also about those who love their partners, like loving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Amongst the people are those who seek, besides Allah, partners, loving them like loving Allah. This is verse 165 in Surah Al-Baqarah. So he who loves any creature like loving Allah, then he is mushrik. Now what kind of love is this? It is the kind of love where you love someone to the degree that you think of him as having some of the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Or you love him to the degree that you think you are obligated to submit to him in everything he says, whatever he says. This is worship. This kind of love is a worship, like what occurs amongst the Shias or some of the Sufis or some of the parties, the deviated parties. They obligate on their followers to take everything from them and not doubt anything. This falls into worship. It is worship. When you give someone, whoever he might be, when you give him this kind of level, that you shouldn't even doubt what he says, whatever he says, even if it's clear that it is against the rule of Allah, the order of Allah, then you should exclude that from your mind. And you should not think that what he is telling you is against the rule of Allah. Like, for example, what Hassan al-Banna said, okay? He says that the da'i, when he reached the level of da'wah, then his banner should be sam'un wa ta'a min ghayri taraddud wala shak wala muraja'a. Hearing and obeying without doubting the order and without hesitation, and sam'un wa ta'a min ghayri shakkin wala muraja'a. Another word, same thing. Anyway, he's putting his followers in this level, that when I order you, or any of the leaders order you, then you should just submit. Okay, they have another saying. They say, ناقش ثم نفذ. نفذ ثم ناقش. First, execute the order. Then, afterwards, go and argue. Afterwards, meaning if you are ordered to kill someone, you go and kill him, slaughter someone without knowing why. Okay, then after that, you go and ask, after what? After you prevented yourself from going to paradise by shedding the blood of a Muslim, for example. Okay, or even if he was not a Muslim. He might be a Christian who has an oath with the Muslims, or a Jew who has an oath with the Muslims, or whatever, who has an oath with the Muslims. You have no right to go and shed his blood. It's a major sin in Islam. The Prophet ﷺ said, he who sheds the blood of someone who has an oath with the Muslims, he will not even smell the smell of paradise. So it's a very big sin. It's not easy just to go and execute the order. So this kind of love, which leads to blind submission to someone, is a worship. And the love of someone, which leads to believing that he knows everything or that he's able to do anything like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this kind of love is worship. And this kind of love leads to belittling Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because you are equaling a human to him. And it is also a kind of mocking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is why probably the Sheikh mentioned it here in mocking. And mocking, the Sheikh says, could be of two kinds. One is the direct mocking, like the one which we mentioned and the verse was revealed for. And the second kind of mocking is the indirect. And this is an ocean. A lot of kinds fall under this, the indirect mocking. Even, the Sheikh says, to move the eyebrow in a way that you symbol it to mock something from the religion. For example, if someone tells you that you have to make tawaf around the Kaaba 7 times, and you say, 7 times? Like this, for example. And by this you mean to deny this and to make fun of it and to belittle it and to show that this is weird. Then you are a kafir by this. So just a flip of the eye could turn you into a kafir. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, paradise is as close to one of you as his shoe, means very close. And hellfire is as such also, is very close to you. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, a person could say a word which he has not paid attention to, and because of that word, he would fall into the deepest part of hellfire, meaning he would become a kafir, because the deepest part is the place of the kafirs. Like bringing out the tongue regarding something from religion. If you do this as a means of belittling Quran or Sunnah or the truth, then you become a kafir by this. Like pressing of the hand. If you mean by that belittling anything from this religion, you become a kafir. So imagine one word, one pressing of the hand, one moving of the tongue, one moving of the eyebrow, any of those could take you to kufr, wal-iyadu billah. Similarly, some people say nowadays, this religion is not suitable for the 20th century, or such and such thing in this religion, not necessarily all the religion. Even if you say applying the hudud, which are the cutting the hand for the thief and things like that, if you say that this is not suitable for this century, you are a kafir, you are not a Muslim. Because it is not any human who has set up those hudud. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has set them up. Anyone who says that this religion takes us back to the dark ages, or that this religion is backwardness, or that such and such ruling in Islam is barbaric, or things like that, this is all kufr. Or even to say that this religion has done injustice to the woman, like many people nowadays say, because of their great ignorance, when the opposite is true, alhamdulillah. And some people say ruling by the man-made rules is more suitable for people than ruling by Islamic rule. And when someone calls to tawheed and forbids people from worshipping the graves, they say he is a fundamentalist and he is such and such, and he wants to split the Muslims. What Muslims? Those who are worshipping the graves are not Muslims. So how could you say we are splitting the Muslims? And we are advising them, we are forbidding them from doing shirk. And the Prophet ﷺ said, أَنَا فَرْقُ بَيْنَ النَّاسِ. I am the criterion of splitting the people. Anyone who follows me is one group. Anyone who doesn't follow me is another group. It's opposed to this group. Even though this person who is following him might be the husband, and the other person who is not following him might be the wife, but they have split. One is a follower of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and one is against him. So they are two groups. They are not one group. A father and a son. One is on this side, the other is on the other side. Or some people say he's a Wahhabi, he has a fifth madhab, or some things like that. They say those things to mock the true aqidah and to mock the people who follow the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam.